اعوذ باللہ من الشیطان الرجیم بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم السلام علیکم and a very warm welcome to World This Morning. I am your host Achra Sati and joining me is my wonderful co-host pronunciation guru and a mentor Fahim Mangesh. Assalam alaikum Fahim, how are you doing today?
Wa alaikum assalam, doing very well, thank you very much. And I love the way how you warmly welcome all the viewers who are watching us. It's wonderful because every morning one has to be warm because that exudes that air, that those energies, the positive energies that you can exude with all the people around you, that really, really helps improve the environment, I would say.
Thank you so much. Jazakallah khair. And may Allah make me more worthy of such sort of comments. But Fahim, I would like to bring your attention towards one important facet that I would say is of the 21st century, of the digital era, that is the use of artificial intelligence and how it is speeding up a lot of processes that we would say were non-existent back in those old days, and especially the fact that how pictures have been manipulated, we've seen,
they have
been created, and so much so that the accuracy is so much so that your naked eye could not detect it unless there is an artificial intelligence software out there, right? So there was this phenomena, and that was very concerning to me, that how pictures were distorted and they look so real in the first place that, you know, you could see that this is the actual picture out there. And I was thinking about it, maybe, you know, in the coming days, so pictures were used to justify or give as a testimony or as a witness, right? So in the coming days, I don't know, we would be unable to differentiate between what is truth
exactly
and what is falsehood.
And
in the
it's actually a bit scary because off and on, all of us, we upload pictures, and
true,
who knows how the pictures might be used in the future as the artificial intelligence grows, becomes
true,
more intelligent. Who knows? I mean, especially in the age of our children, when they grow old.
True, true.
I mean, it's kind of scary. It gives me those jitters at times when I think about it in
That's
depth.
True.
So yeah, you're right. Artificial intelligence is growing, and perhaps pictures would not be used as a testimony anymore.
That's very true. And I think one of the very concerning thing is that once you upload the picture, it is going to remain with that software forever,
yes,
right? You cannot retract it. You cannot delete it. It will remain there forever. And this is very worrying and scary part. And I also think, Fahim, a lot of times, because all of us are using social media, and the way we use social media, we fail to differentiate between how it's not our personal diary, rather it's an open platform where people are commenting, where people are interacting. And I've always maintained that the social media is a very average form of the social media, or very average medium, because the way people are interacting there, it's very mediocre. The conversations are very mediocre. If you
and
want
not,
to
not just about the interactions, the things which are shared,
that's
you
true
don't know whether they're true or not. You don't have any way, because a common man, a journalist would definitely go and talk about those things to other people, talk
true
about the source of the information. But a normal man, a layman, would believe that. And that's the source of the misinformation, the disinformation that keeps on spreading around in the society. And that's how we get false information, which is then thought of to be as true.
That's very true. And the element of virality into this phenomena is even more concerning. But let's move on to our top stories. So yesterday there was a chairlift operation done, and all our eyes were glued to the screen because, according to ISPR, General Officer Commanding the Special Services Group himself led the operation. It is said that the slinging team of the SSG of Pakistan Army safely rescued people trapped in the chairlift at the height of 600 feet in Buttgram. The all persons trapped in the chairlift have been moved to safe spaces on the special instructions of the Army Chief. The talented team of Army Aviation and SSG started the rescue operation. The team, with the help of Pakistan Air Force, local administration, cable experts, demonstrated their skills by carrying out this unique operation in the history of Pakistan. And the Army has always responded to the voice of people in every testing time, and has stood and will continue to stand with the people in every hour of difficulty.
That's quite true, Hajra, because whenever we have any calamity, be it a natural disaster, be it a man-made disaster, for example, the event that we had yesterday, Each and every eye was glued to the television, and it was about 9 to 10 hours, perhaps.
That's true.
And the way the army and the SSG worked for it and tried to save the people, it's commendable in, all its forms and manifestations, I would say. Beautifully done. It was just like a movie, but definitely not for the people who were trapped, because definitely they are going to have that PTSD perhaps for the rest of their lives. Perhaps they won't be able to go to any tall heights. Perhaps they won't be able to go into a chairlift again. And perhaps they would be having nightmares about this, but that's what PTSD is all about. And I hope that they get the treatment for that as well, because these sorts of things, they remain in your mind, in your personality. They get embedded in your personality for the rest of your life. So I hope the best, and my best wishes are for all of those who survived this very, very scary event which happened yesterday.
That's very true, and I think just by looking at the screens as the spectators, it was very horrifying scene at the first eye, especially when we were looking at from the comforts of our home. But alhamdulillah, they have all been rescued, and it was a momentous feat to achieve in the first place, because it was not an easy operation in that mountainous terrain. It was a tough terrain, but alhamdulillah, it has happened. So now moving on to our topic and kickstart our conversation forward, which is regarding the discourses related to the climate change, Fahim. United Nations Secretary General Antonio Guterres has warned the world, warned the globe, the humanity, that the era of global boiling has arrived. And I think we living in Pakistan can literally feel the heat of those words in a more proverbial sense too, in a more literal sense too, right? Because we have seen how the climate abnormalities are taking shape there, how weather patterns are getting disturbed there, and it is sparking a massive round of, I would say, a lifestyle changes in Pakistan and across the world.
And Hajra, till last year we were saying that Pakistan is in a very vulnerable position. The geographical position of Pakistan is such that it's prone to a lot of natural calamities like those. But this year, Hajra, we've seen something different that the whole world. We've seen a lot of natural calamities happening in the US, in the north of America. And that is something really, really something to ponder upon, food for thought, especially for all those countries who are developed, who are contributing a lot to the global warming, or should I rather say global boiling.
That's very true. And and another wave of the climate-induced migration will start, which is going to create lots of other problems across the world, because global south is going to become so uninhabitable because of the rising temperatures, that obviously people have to move, and that will spark a lot of conflict. But what are the ramifications?
Not just people, but also the animals, because I was watching this documentary the other day about the animal. It was called Our Planet, and it was beautiful on one hand, but on the other, it showed how they're getting impacted by global warming, how they're getting impacted by human behavior. So I think now is the time that everybody should sit together on a very serious note and talk about it and do something about it.
That's very true. So without any further ado, we would like to introduce our guest. We are very glad that we have been joined by one of our favorite climate change analysts, and he also happens to be an environmentalist, Dr. Ijaz Ahmed. Assalamu alaikum, sir, and thank you so much for once again
joining
our show.
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum. Right. Thank you for having me, and I always enjoy having such a discussion.
I mean, it's always a pleasure having you here and you gracing our studio. So, sir, era of global boiling has arrived. Yes. This is a very forestalk warning. I don't think so it's a warning. I think it's a reality which has wrapped a lot of repercussions for us as a humanity, right? So, what can be done to improve our lot?
Well, I think situation, as both of you as mentioned, is getting worse and worse. And situation regarding the temperature, regarding the impact of climate change and global warming is worse. I mean, like every year it is getting more and more calamities are actually coming up. We have seen that in last decades, Europe and America were quite safe. But we are witnessing that situation in Europe and in USA has also deteriorated over a period of time. And I think blessing in disguise, in a sense that, okay, they will also now realize that whatever though the southern countries were facing, now they have started facing. It's very rude to say, very selfish to say, but I think it is reality, in a sense that in order to recognize the pain of other, I think it's good to have a little pain.
actually, you're right. They need to empathize with the people who are actually suffering from the pain, because they have all the technology to perhaps rebuild, restructure, and build the infrastructure all over again. We, as a country where we are economically, we don't.
We don't, and also I think it will take time to reach to that technology, to that capacity. So like we have witnessed, as we were talking earlier, that July was the hottest month in Europe, and June in Pakistan was one of the coldest months.
Coldest.
So this is a very big contradiction, in a sense that we used to get hot weather in June.
True.
So this year, throughout Pakistan, we have seen that June was very pleasant comparatively.
Right.
Even July to some extent. But the situation is actually, you know, like getting worse, in a sense that we also have witnessed very humid conditions during this July and also in August. I mean, like today, and I think last week also, we witnessed this high humidity. And ultimately, this is going to have impact on food security as well, in a sense that, you know, with the increase in humidity, insect actually population increases, and there is a concern now, actually, you know, like maybe we can have, we may have some locust emerging, and you know, like things like that will start happening. So which is quite alarming, in a sense, you know, like we're talking about migration, we're talking about social issues, economic issues, and then ultimately food crisis and food security issue will also
Also, sir, you just mentioned insects, right? The other day I was having a discussion with someone that the way we used to watch the fireflies, even grasshoppers in our childhood, ladybugs, we don't see that anymore.
Yes.
And are they going towards extinction? And if they do, I mean, and honeybees as well. Because they say if the honeybees are gone, all the food's gone.
Yes.
So where's the world heading towards?
Well, I think this is very important, that these are some of the indicators where we need to look into that, what are the reasons. I mean, like whether it is the change in temperature or the urbanization of those areas, which were, I mean, like habitat for these insects. And ultimately, you'll see it is a combination of both climate change as well as the urbanization. Unfortunately, the urban planning is another disaster that we need to actually, we are planning to go into disaster, in a sense that we don't see whether the place where we are building a housing colony, is it better if it is used for agriculture purpose or for some orchard or etc. We know, you know, like what is happening in Multan, that all the mango trees in certain areas are being removed, and ultimately housing colony is being established. So without, I mean, like maybe, I mean, like if we see 5 or 10 kilometers from there, you will find a better place for housing. So I think there are now there need to be certain policies where strict action should be taken in any bad urban planning. All these insects were there, even in Lahore I have seen you know, like firefly, and used to, you know, like follow sometime in our childhood, and now you don't see that, unfortunately.
But sir, we also need to address an elephant in the room, which is the way we are leading our lifestyles, right? So they are so lavish, they're so luxurious in the first place. So let's just talk about the plastic. You know, the amount of the plastic that we use or we interact with in our lifestyle, it's so huge, and that is destroying the ecosystem in the first place. So for example, we went to northern areas, and you can find that instead of plastic waste, there used to be that, I don't know how to call it, that wooden sort of a basket, woven basket there, where they were putting all of the waste. So plastic was not there a century before in our lifestyle, but now it's such an important part of our life that we are unable to extricate ourselves from that, right? What sort of lifestyle changes do you think we have to make, and do you think that lifestyle changes scares us, the humanity, so much that we are unwilling to take steps that could reduce the climate change in the first place and stop our extinction as a humanity in general.
I think you very rightly pointed out that the biggest issue is our lifestyle.
True.
Change in the lifestyle. I'm like, I'm not talking about, you know, like 100 years from now, mm-hmm. just 25, 30 years ago, we used to have fewer vehicles.
Right.
People used to commute, you know, like on public transport. There were private bikes, private vans, etc. Even the government transport system.
Right.
I've been traveling during my childhood, even
True.
When I was going to college in Rawalpindi.
Yes.
I used to take Omni bus from Islamabad to Rawalpindi.
Mm.
And I was not the only one. It will be right on time, mm. very cheap, available till 9 o'clock at night, which Islamabad normally used to close at 6 o'clock.
Yes.
So these, I think, things changed. The facilities which was provided by the government actually slowly was monopolized by private sector.
Mm.
And the government transport system, which is, you know, like is important, was gone. So the private sector came and they actually manipulated.
Mm.
So people started keeping cars. So now if you see even a small house will have at least one or two cars.
Right.
Everyone in the house will have its own vehicle.
True.
Without, I mean, like, what happens then?
Hmm.
We need to expand roads.
Right.
Expand road at the cost of what?
Forest. Cover. Yes.
And then the carbon emission, increase True. In carbon emission. So all these things, I mean, like 40 to 45% of air pollution
right.
Is because of the vehicular emissions. So, and we talk about smog.
True.
So, I mean, like, and
the fifth season nowadays.
It is coming.
Yes.
Yeah.
And then, you know, like the quality of the petrol that we are using, mm. or even the chingji rickshaws, mm-hmm. Bikes, etc., public transport vehicles, mm. buses, etc., which they are using, it's not up to that standard. The quality is not good enough. So ultimately, all these things are contributing in, you know, like degrading the environment.
Mm.
And only, you know, like if we try to understand that if I am using something, do I need it?
Hmm.
I think a lot of problems will be solved.
Hmm.
Whether it's a plastic bag, whether it's commuting on a vehicle, I am going alone, my brother is going in his vehicle, and, you know, like carpooling is almost not existence, unfortunately. Everyone wants to have his own vehicle. So I think there are some fundamental thinking, thought processes which are required in order to coming back to the situation that we were.
And also, Doctor, capitalism aside, as individuals, the thought process needs to change because
right.
many people are solarizing their houses, not because of environment,
no.
because of electricity bills.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Many people are using electric cars because A, they're cooler. B,
fashion.
They're expensive,
yeah.
so you can, you know,
trendy,
tell
yeah.
the world, okay,
yeah.
I have money,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
So don't you think these things should be made cheaper so that people should think more about the environment and less about fashion and, you know, being cool out there? Because even I know someone who just went to China and she was like, by 2030, all the cars over there are going to be electric cars.
Yes.
And she said, such stylish, good cars for a common man. It's a norm in China.
Yes.
And obviously, there's a lot of marketing that they are very green,
right.
they're using cleaner yeah. energy, but at the end, the silicon through which they are made in the first place, the batteries, they do not decompose in the first place, right? So it's not very environment friendly in the first place. It's just the marketing, how they are doing it to capture a broader audience out there, especially when the conversations of the climate change are so pertinent.
Yeah, it is. Unfortunately, you know, like there are again fundamental issues in our strategizing and planning. We don't have capacity to, I mean, like what we'll do is we'll bring all the vehicles from China or from other countries without establishing technology here. I mean, unless we have our own technology, unless we have our own production here, we are going to be, you know, like dependent on other countries. And if they stop, if they change their policy, so we'll be stuck. So I think we need to invest on human resource, technology transfer. I'll just give you example that I mean, like in different governments, we used to distribute a laptop,
right.
Which I think is a wonderful thing to do.
Initiative.
But we never thought about having our own industry of, you know, like manufacturing laptops or some part of laptop. So, and every year if we are, you know, like distributing 100,000 or maybe 500,000 or 2 million, just imagine if we develop our own technology, we can actually export it to other countries as well. So there is, I think, a gap in the planning. We always feel to bring things from outside without, you know, like looking at the cost of it.
Right.
If we spend money on our own industry, our own technology,
right.
I think it will be adopted quickly, and we'll not be facing, you know, like issues related to foreign exchange, etc., etc.
Well, Doctor, that's a very pertinent point that you raised here, because they say that you give a man a fish and he will not be hungry for a day, and you teach a man how to fish and he will never be hungry for the rest of his life. So we need to become self-reliant in this day and age. We've come to the point that we need to lessen our imports, and that's exactly how we can do it, by improving our own industry. Thank you, Dr. Sir, for coming here.
Thank you
for
so
giving
much.
Us your time.
Thank
it was
you.
A pleasure having you and talking to you.
Thank you.
But we need to go for a short break, and we will be back. And after that, we have a very interesting discussion lined up. Stay tuned. Welcome back to World This Morning with Hajar Sethi and Fahim Bangush. Well, now the second segment that we were talking about earlier, I'm not just happy but also excited to introduce our guest today. Our guest is one of my former colleagues when PTV World started, and now the feat that she's achieved, it's really great, and I'm very proud to introduce Miss Saira Ahmed here with us in the studios. Saira, welcome to PTV World and World This Morning, and of course, a very good morning.
Thank you very much. It's an honor to be back to PTV after such a long time. I'm feeling so excited, actually. Thank you.
Lovely.
I mean, it must be nostalgia, because PTV has been home to us. It has groomed us. It's an academy unto itself, and we are really, really proud of the legacy of PTV. But Saira, let's kickstart a conversation. Alhamdulillah, so you have written a book. And the book's name is Life of a Sufi in Search of a Divine.
Yes, here is the book. We can show it to our viewers. This is Life of a Sufi in Search of Divine. Something that I think all of us are looking for, the divine.
That's very true, Saira. Let's kickstart a conversation. What is this book about? If someone wants to read it, I feel it's a short book, right? So it's short books are trendy nowadays a lot, right? And I think that's a very good thing to be, have short books, because of the attention span that has been damaged a lot by the short social media
oh, yes.
and the short reels and whatnot. So what is in there in the book, and take us through all the journey of this book.
Thank you very much. For the book, I would say that, you know, it's my personal search for the divine, as it is mentioned in the book as well. And when I started writing this book last year, in 2022, I was in with a family vacation in Guna in Egypt.
Uh-huh.
And I was thinking, I had some thoughts of writing different characters that I have experience and I have met,
mm-hmm.
and I thought, why not write a book? So I started writing, and it was very creative, interesting, because I felt that I lived each and every character.
Okay.
This book is about it's about a person who faced difficulties. It's not
right.
related to any religious sect or nationality that I always focus
it's
on.
It's a fiction.
It's a fiction novel,
right.
but it has real characters as well.
Okay.
However, it also talks about how a person, you know, goes through different trials and tests, all of us. Mm-hmm. It's not one person or the, because we see from the outer side mm-hmm. that everyone is happy and we have a competition true. In our daily life, but it's not true. Mm. All of us are facing certain dilemma in the life and true. How to go through that with faith in the heart. So the story is about a person who found and he got inspired by the revelations of Hazrat Jalaluddin Rumi and Shams Tabriz.
Lovely. Right. And as far as you were concerned, because you authored it, what gave you the motivation and inspiration to write about this particular subject?
Okay, so for the motivation was like, it's as I said, it's my personal search for the divine. I felt when I felt that there is a need to create a hope and peace in the world, because what we are living in, because of the difficult different wars, the Ukraine war, the Turkey earthquake, the disasters that we face every day, every one of us is frustrated. And to give an inspiration to everyone that whatever we are facing in this life is temporary, it's gonna pass away, nothing is permanent, everything has an end, and what we are facing now, it is just our test, you know. And everyone is tested, but how to cope up with that? So this is the story of a person who realized who a real Sufi is.
Right. I'm sorry I'm interjecting here, but Saya, since fiction and literature is a subject that is very close to my heart, and it is said that every fiction has some sort of encapsulation of the reality in it, right? So it is inspired by the reality, and art is always, in imitation of yourself in a particular place. So you talked about that it is inspired by your own journey towards in search of higher love, in search of divine, and there's a lot that is being written about the Rumi, especially in the West, about Sufism, and it is often linked with the peace, with the meditation, with inner satisfaction in the first place. But again, when you have these discourses around Sufism, so one very particular pertinent one that comes into is that it wants you to disassociate yourself with the entire world, right? And it wants you to go inside in search of your own reality, in search of your own higher love. Do you believe with this assertion that it's a correct assertion to disassociate yourself completely with the reality, with the world, with your social society, social connections, and then revert back inside you?
I think it's my personal experience is quite different. I think that it's not that you disassociate yourself from anything. There is a balance, you know. God has created a balance in the world, and there is a spiritual world also, but not for everyone the door is open. I could not write without the divine guidance. So this is very inspirational for me, and talking about Sufism, or because we have a certain myth in our, especially in South Asia. I will talk about, I'm not living here for a long time now, and I have traveled internationally to many countries and met so many people and made so many friends in different culture. I realized that we're all humans, and dissociating or associating yourself from the real life struggles is not what a Sufi does. It is to find a balance in the world with the faith and with the help of with helping each other.
Right.
So I will say that one word that you know. I'm writing the second book on Hazrat Sheikh Abdul Qadir Jilani, and he said that there is in your heart there is only one thing that can stay, either the love of God or either the love of the world. So the love of world, you know, sometimes it takes us away from the real real life,
from
actually
higher love,
for the higher love, the higher love. Once you have the higher love, everything is fine,
right?
Just remembering that you have someone, you don't need anyone in this life. They are different characters. It's just like a drama in a life,
right?
It's temporary. It's like to help each other,
right?
So it is a message of helping the mankind, thinking beyond ourselves, thinking beyond us.
Right.
I'm working in international organization for quite some time.
Wonderful.
And before as well. But I felt that what I'm doing here, if I'm not giving a message, because I'm here for temporarily for some time in the world.
True.
Maybe this can help someone.
Right. That's wonderful. A thought on the first place. And we do have some visual representation in the form of the video of yours, Saya, and we would like to play it. And then I will carry forward this conversation ahead. So let's take a look.
Thank you.
that was indeed lovely, and gave me flute always gives me goosebumps, really.
Wonderful.
And Rumi has written a lot about flutes.
Yes.
And the pain in the flute, it's I can't really explain it.
And then I think the visual representation of Istanbul and of whirling dervishes, because Istanbul always try to market itself, you know, with the representation of whirling dervishes and mosques and whatnot. So Saira, so you have lots of care. What are some of the sub themes that we can find in your book? Obviously, it's about Sufism. It's about the quest for the higher meaning, the quest for the humanity in the first place. But I'm pretty sure there must be some sub themes and the characters and the plots. Can you shed some light on that?
Yeah, so the main theme, the main character of the book is, there are different characters, you know.
Right.
And when I was writing and I was living each character, it's very different, you know. It's like you are feeling the emotions. It's not easy. You go into this character,
right,
like you're doing a movie, you know. Mm-hmm. You go into the character, you feel the emotions. So it's about different characters. The one that actually which I'm very fond of is Mario. Mario is a Lebanese character, from Mount Lebanon, which is in the mountains. And how different events happened in his life that, you know, I cannot go much into detail to break the suspense. But then, you know, when he had nothing left, when he said, I have seen so much.
Mm.
So, and then how then God actually contacted him and, you know, gave him guidance, you know, actually Sufism is absolute submission to the divine, absolute submission. Mm. You know that whatever is happening, it's not happening without a reason. It's not happening without our will, with our, you know, efforts.
Right.
Nothing we are gaining in this life from efforts. I would like to, you know, narrate a quote from
please,
Rumi,
please,
go ahead.
Which is the starting of the novel, which says that, goodbyes are only for those who love with their eyes. Goodbyes are only for those who love with their eyes, because for those who love with heart and soul, there is no such thing as separation. So when I was reading that and writing that, and how Mario actually interpreted the revelations of Rumi, he realized that there is a separation because we all are afraid of death.
Right.
Yeah.
But in reality, there is no separation. We go to another world.
True.
But
it's just a stage of path.
It's a stage of path.
Yeah.
And in the end, actually, it also talks about Derveshi dance. What is a Derveshi dance is? You will see in the novel that the reeling Dervishis and how they do in Konya. There is a mehfil called Sabze Noreus Mehfil,
okay,
which I would be attending and invited in December.
Wonderful.
In the celebration of Rumi's birthday. So,
lovely.
And that, you know, the reeling dervish is, what is the state of mind? It's not that you're doing it without any soul purpose.
Mm-hmm.
It's so divine. And in the end, when it's a suspense novel, it's a fiction novel, and it has, you will see that there are so many geographical locations, different cultures, different mindset, but all going through one, you know, one direction. And that is when they realize that, you know, okay, we are here, but we have to do something. So in the end, the last quote that I mentioned in my book is by Rumi, the minute I heard my first love story, I started looking for you, not knowing how blind that was. Lovers don't finally meet somewhere. They are in each other all along.
Lovely. Because I was once having this discussion about Sufism with somebody, and the discussion arose to the point that what is Sufism, basically, and a lot of discussions, a lot of discourses have gone on in the world regarding this particular question. And I was given the answer that finding peace in the most arduous of circumstances and finding that union with God Almighty, with the divine, that is what Sufism is all about. Because when you find that union with the divine, you are absolutely contented with everything that you have, and all you want to do is please in the sense that help out whatever creation there is of God Almighty. And even you know, in the past, WHO, the definition of health that WHO used to give used to be about mental and physical health. But now it has changed.
spiritual.
It speaks about the mental, physical, and spiritual health.
That's
because
true.
Until unless you're spiritually healthy, true. You cannot be called 100% healthy. And that's what true. That's where the peace comes from. That's where the tranquility comes from. Also, Saira, I remember you were our former colleague back in 2013 when the channel started. Did you have any idea at that time that perhaps one day you're going to author a book and perhaps one day you're going to get that close to the divine and find that path of Sufism inside you?
No, not really. Not at all, I would say, because I was living a very, you know, a superficial life, I would say, as most of us do. And my heart was closed. My heart was not open. I think I started changing in the last 2-3 years. The last 3-4 years had been very, just changed me and just, you know,
enlightened
me and gave me another vision of life.
True.
You know, other vision of life that was not open to me at that time. But right. when I was working in PTV, it was such a pleasure to work. I would say I learned a lot. I'm so honored to work in Pakistan Television. And to be the face of the TV, that was something so big for me. And it helped me in my career. I worked in different organizations after that, but it really helped me. But really, Fahim, I wasn't aware of what I'm gonna do. But I had this passion for. I was very creative from the start. I wanted to write. I used to write like few pages, but you know, used to leave it. I didn't have this urge how to write it. I couldn't write anything without divine guidance. I couldn't.
Right.
When I That's found true. The guidance, I started writing. My pen was not me. It
right.
was the words from above. So it was different.
That's very
Lovely.
True. And I think we had this conversation. I had this conversation a lot of times with Fahim. And I would also like to pose this question to you. The answer is up to you. So we've seen, especially after 9/11, that how the literature surrounding Pakistan has been seen with the lens of extreme securitization. If you will see novels, there was a lot of polarization, there was a lot of fragmentation in the society, and a lot of authors used to write that to entice the Western audiences to fit their stereotypes and not the real
True.
Representation
True.
Of Pakistan. So you will find a lot of novels of Mohsen Hamid like that, you know, where they are characters who are diving deep into the terrorism or the extremism or whatnot, right? And that's not real Pakistan. Pakistan is more than that. Do you think that it was our responsibility, people from the Pakistan, from the global south, to write about their country, their representation, their land that has a true representation of that? And how much do you think that has damaged Pakistan's reputation abroad? And do you think that now that lens is breaking off, we are seeing lots of different stories, lots of different characters, lots of different traditions and myths about Pakistan, which are the true representation and which we can claim in the first place?
I think I cannot agree more from you. What I understand is that the world where we are going is so, influenced, especially the Pakistani society. Whenever I come, I feel that if we are so influenced by the West and we are so influenced by the others, you know, whatever they are doing, we think that this is right. We have to be, I think, what I did was I adopted with the other Western culture, the Arab culture, but not leaving my identity.
True.
I'm really proud to, when I started writing it and it was published by international author in the Europe Books worldwide, I was proud to say, and for them, were the first Pakistani international author as an emerging author for 2022. So it was, I felt that I did something for Pakistan.
No, that's a proud right. moment for us as well. And honestly, with the conditions that we're living in,
True.
The polarization, the way people are not confident enough, they're not patient enough, definitely this might help somebody out there.
True.
And we really hope so. And perhaps it might help me to start with yeah, because I'm definitely going to give this a read.
And thank you so much, Saira, for coming here, and we are wishing you best of luck for your book. I wish that it flourishes in the world of literature, and especially when
yes.
people are predicting the death of the book, which I do not believe in the first place. But thank you so much once again
thank
for coming
you.
To our show.
And wonderful having you.
And
thank
until
you.
Next time, it's a goodbye and Allah Hafiz and good morning.
Good morning.